These sharks are thinking hard and clear.
Sharks got smarter.
What does an 8,000-pound Mako shark with a brain the size of a flathead V8 engine and no natural predators think about?
She screwed with the sharks, and now the sharks are screwing with us.
Our motto for the movie was, you can swim, but you can't hide. It's a big-scale horror film.
Okay, go with the shark.
We're using the biggest water tanks in the world.
Wow. I've never played the richest man in the world before.
Beneath its glassy surface, a world of gliding monsters.
They asked me to get in the water with the shark.
They're using live sharks. Dun, 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 dun.
This huge shark grabs the gurney, pulls it down.
Dump a bit of water on them, and we're at the bottom going, what am I doing on this ladder with burning debris falling around me?
What this movie is really about is smart sharks. At this facility called Aquatica, shark research is being done. Things go wrong, the sharks turn against their host.
It's a cat and mouse game with sharks and humans.
It is the deep blue sea. There's a race against time to find a way to get up to the surface so we won't get trapped by the sharks.
The movie is really a survival story.
We systematically kill them.
There's many surprises as to who lives and who dies in this movie.
This is a very eclectic bunch of people put together in the middle of the ocean.
The sharks are a major character in this movie and have a real personality, a nasty personality, I might add.
He's the guy that can lead them out of here. If anybody can lead them out of there, Samuel L. Jackson.
Just what the hell did you do to those sharks?
Coming up next.
We are here in the Bahamas at Stewart Coves, shooting sharks. The footage of the live sharks will be cut together with the scenes that sometimes feature mechanical sharks, sometimes digitally generated sharks. Our goal is really to have a seamless story where you will never be able to tell whether you are dealing with real sharks or something that movie magic has created. We definitely put the actors in contact with the real sharks.
We can never be totally prepared because the sharks are somewhat unpredictable in the way they're going to approach the camera and approach the talent.
Only so much you can do when you go underwater with sharks, but just give everybody a good safety meeting and jump in. And after that, we're in the hands of the sharks.
You're gonna be in the water with a lot of sharks, and you're gonna get kind of used to them. But don't, because they have lots and lots of teeth, and these are wild sharks.
We have just put the shark cage in the water, and we are just positioning it. And after that, we are going to swim to the cage. But the part that is a little unclear is, you have to be in the cage, of course, for the sharks, but you have to swim to the cage. So we just hope that the sharks don't get us on the way. One of our actors, Thomas Jane, who plays Carter in the story, is about to get in the water and act with the sharks.
I've been scared of sharks all my life. Ever since I saw Jaws, they were, I knew they were everywhere. They're terrifying.
When Thomas is swimming through the sharks, he's got to really keep his hands in, like this. One thing about these sharks, these aren't like your neighborhood dog. You know, dogs have teeth, but these guys are wild, and they bite, they'll rip your arm right off.
I'm real happy to be swimming with the sharks.
Yeah. What they do, you know, they have rows and rows of these razor sharp teeth, and they grab onto you, and they just saw. And they'll go right through it, they'll go through your bone and everything.
I would say they're not gonna be scared of your kids.
Anybody have any questions?
I'll take care of them.
All right, well, let's go shoot some sharks.
I have to go in the water also to direct the sharks.
At one point, I wanted to be a marine biologist because I always thought that inner space was a lot more interesting than outer space. You know, we don't know what's out there or if there's anything out there. There's stuff under the water that we know lives there, you know, is in charge. And when we're down there, we're not in charge. And I think this is that kind of film where people will be able to relate to us not being able to handle certain situations.
Did someone order the fish?
What in God's creation?
Oh, not his. Ours.
They are performing some tests on the shark,
The shark is supposed to be tranquilized.
You did it.
It's such an extreme environment. You know, it's an immediate response. It's completely instinctive. You're scared of this bloody thing that's in the water, you know.
Absolutely no desire at all to go be with the real sharks. Don't want to be with the real sharks. Don't want to see them. I don't want to hear about them.
You could not study the shark and not end up liking it or just thinking how magnificent it is and how amazing they are.
The sharks never get cancer or go blind or show any loss of brain activity as they age.
And they are really nature's perfect creation. They never sleep, they never stop moving, they don't get many diseases, they just keep going, and they have no natural predators. And when they look at a human and think that it's maybe a seal or a dolphin, they can come at you.
If people knew how many sharks they're swimming with when they go to the beach, they wouldn't go to the beach. Coast Guard knows.
So this time, Thomas just doesn't want to have any scuba gear. He's just going to go au naturel, because the sharks don't have any scuba gear, right?
That's right. I don't want to give a disappear advantage.
Okay, but you do have a glove.
Yeah.
Okay.
If I get bit, it's this hand.
Excellent.
Great. Have fun. Thanks. All right.
I challenge anybody to tell me what is real, what is not. We had a couple of close calls where the sharks bumped actors or the crew members, and it taught us to be very careful. Wow. Fantastic.
They're getting feisty. They were getting
okay, then let's call it a day.
Yeah, they're like biting on his head and stuff.
Okay. Oh, that's all you need to say.
Oh, we're trying to mount him down here.
Yeah, sharky. I live.
Steve, sharks were with us today.
That's a wrap. Good work, Thomas.
There's nothing scarier than something that is real.
We are here in the elevator shaft. This elevator shaft was built to be 40 feet high just because of technical reasons of shooting in it and making it safe for the actors and being practical here on stage. But in the movie, it'll appear to be 150 feet high. In the sequence, we have characters trying to escape from the flooded facility through the elevator shaft. They are between the devil and the deep blue sea. The ladder falls across the shaft. Characters are left hanging from the ladder right above the shark, and of course, at least one of them falls in the water. What we are trying to do here is really show the shark. You can look at it swimming, circling around, coming to you, biting you.
There's a lot of times when the actors aren't acting, they're just reacting, and having the 8,000 pound shark thrashing them, throwing water at you, that's not fake, you know, that's like a real thing doing it. We took the approach of like, let's recreate the shark. So we basically have tried to mimic the entire shark in one piece. And in Jaws, for instance, they had pieces of sharks. They had a head, they had a side. And here we are 20 years later, technology, everything's advanced incredibly.
She's sleeping like a baby.
The shark actually swims on its own. Inside is much more akin to aerospace technology.
I still don't believe that that thing isn't real.
They're computer driven so that their actions in the water are completely natural. They've been modeled after actual footage of Mako sharks swimming in the waters.
You will be running this way over the coffee table and then behind the desk. Then the shark will rip the desk apart.
The number one thing with sharks is they're always cruising kind of slowly. But when they snap and go, it's this incredible burst of energy. One of our biggest challenges was actually capturing that speed and energy for these lunges.
It's in my bedroom where I'm kind of confronted by a shark. Ow! fantastic to do because you're at such close range to it, and it's it literally comes up there, you know, to my nose and attacks me.
Big time Hollywood horror, action, suspense, thriller. Today I'm battling sharks. The shark, this particular Gen 1 shark, in my kitchen. He's chasing me.
Action!
The same shark, by the way, when I got barreled by the seawater.
3, 2, 1, go!
Put it this way, you see I'm bleeding already, so let's leave it at that.
One of the most interesting things of this film is that the sharks enter man's environment. Here the sharks are going inside of corridors, they're going inside kitchens, they're going inside of bedrooms, and yet that world's still flooded, so it's their world. So there's very specific things that were storyboarded that the shark had to do.
And action.
The Walt Conte sharks are huge, powerful, incredibly fast machines. For something that big, it's really frightening. It'd be like dancing with an automobile on a freeway. In a lot of cases, we're opting to either do things at a slow speed or do them as a visual effect, as a CG shark.
Right here, we have a very typical scene for Deep Blue Sea, which is basically a shark eating a person, like this. This scene, however, was quite complicated. First of all, we had to go to Mexico to these giant tanks where they shot Titanic and build our sets. And to get this very powerful moment where the shark actually comes and grabs him, we couldn't do it even with the animatronic shark, not to even mention a real shark, because they are really hard to train to be gentle. So we created it in the computer. Then we had to have an actor do a certain kind of a stunt where it looks like he's being grabbed by the shark, and when those elements are put together, it seems pretty real.
But this guy is Mr. Stunt Guy.
Pacing, the editing and music is very, very important, because when you add scary music, you tell our psyche how to feel about it, and we get scared. So our composer, Trevor Rabin, came up with hundreds of different ideas.
What is that?
Horror, the melodic side, it was really a different genre almost to where I'd been before. And then I saw the footage and I just thought, this is terrifying. Coming up with the theme for the sharks was probably the most important single musical element. In this film, the more ominous or threatening instrument is actually kind of a calm piano kind of sound. And that kind of sets up the potential threat.
This to really terrorize the audience.
Somebody, please, tell me what that is.
We're using real sharks, so that's gonna really be, you know, people are actually getting eaten on the film, and it's real sharks killing the actors, and that's never been done before.
The actors would come to me and say, Rennie, I have this little idea about a script change, you know, like, on page 78, when I die, how about I kill the shark and I live?
So I think that's gonna be scary. I mean, I know that my death scene's coming up. You know, I got my will made up, and I know that some other actors, you know, we've had some attorneys down here, everybody's getting their wills, because this is it.
Could it be that when the shark eats me, I actually end up in its stomach?
And it's a career move. It's definitely something that, it's a choice, and it could affect your career later, but I mean, that's just the kind of people that are involved with this movie.
You've seen how bad things can get and how quick they can get that way. And they can get a whole lot worse. So we're not going to fight anymore! We're going to pull ourselves together and find a way out of here. We're gonna seal off this pool.
My whole approach to this movie was, no more hiding sharks. This time you're gonna really see them. And to accomplish that, I realized that I had to build animatronic sharks with airplane technology, where these sharks actually move underwater, completely remote controlled, on their own power, moving their tails, their gills move, their eyes move, their jaws move, and so on. The real challenge was that this movie is not a supernatural outer space movie or a fantasy about creatures that don't exist anymore. This is about sharks, and we've seen sharks on Discovery Channel. We know what they look like, and these had to be completely convincing. So first of all, the animatronic sharks had to be built really well. It took about 8 months to create them.
We always had faith in Walt Conti, who built Free Willy and Anaconda. Absolutely. We were working with Walt from the beginning, drawings through the models, through the construction, through the testing.
One day, we're walking the Aquatica set, figuring out some camera angles or something, and the tiger shark swam by. And at first, we all just, because we're jaded movie people, looked down and said, "Oh, yeah, tiger shark." And then somebody like, "Is that what, you know?" I thought we were going out to sea to shoot sharks, and then Walt walked by with his little remote control, you know, going, pretty cool, huh?
We always start by like immersing ourselves in video. It's like we look at, for weeks, we just look at every single thing that's been shot on sharks, and we actually look at it frame by frame by frame to try to analyze the motion, because it's all about capturing that motion and the kind of the personality or essence of what a shark is. Like, a shark is all about teeth. And getting the teeth right was really, really important. That coupled with the jaws, up to this date, everyone kind of makes these jaws that move together. The shark's jaws actually float in their skull. They have a very peculiar, very specific kind of motion. Inside, it's actually quite complex. It's much more akin to aerospace technology. We basically borrow a lot of things that are flying in 747s and other airplanes. It's a lot of that technology, a lot of the hydraulics, electronics, and computer stuff. And that's the stuff that makes them go. Certainly, there's always a lot of nervousness. It's like, if the shark doesn't work, the film doesn't work. And certainly, we had some history of doing believable animals. But until they actually saw the first footage of the first shark, everyone always wondered, is it going to look like rubber? Is it going to look fake? And then when they saw that first footage, it was, oh my gosh, here's, you know, it's a real shark.
We had these mechanical sharks, which the biggest one which actually plays in this scene is a 25-foot shark, which weighs 8,000 pounds and has a 1,000 horsepower engine. So when you imagine this kind of an 8,000 pound animal moving 35 miles an hour underwater, it's real precision work, because it's like a big runaway truck and you don't want it to go to the wrong place.
In the wet lab is this incredible long scene where the shark basically is there in broad daylight for many, many pages of dialogue. And that was probably one of the scenes that people were most worried about, because it's not a lunge. It's the shark sedated, actually, which is not how you're used to seeing sharks. That was probably one of the biggest challenges, just from, like, believability.
She's sleeping like a baby.
Those sharks are just as dangerous as real sharks, because they're so... the power of their of them is so incredible. So they can actually kill you.
The computer actually is used to record moves, so we're able to create this performance in this very specific lunge where it's biting off an actor's arm and ripping it off in one take.
3, 2, 1, action.
That was one of the more tricky shots, and initially everyone just assumed we were going to do visual effects and we're going to paint in the arm. We were able to program the shark to leap over, grab the arm, and rip it off. And we had 9 or 10 cameras going. It's something people haven't seen. There's no trickery there.
When it comes to doing your own stunts, I'm not very much into that. The first time I saw one of those electronic sharks, I thought it was a real one.
Oh, here we go.
With the technology that we have now, with computers, with digital work, and animatronics, which are all computer controlled, you can look at it swimming, circling around, coming to you.
Ready?
Biting you.
Thomas.
Yeah.
Eating you.
And way back.
ripping you apart.
We want to go once again, run away?
You know, the dialogue went on and finally was, yes, but she was decapitated. That's all right.
She was in the shark was driving her up, she had to hold her breath, she was pulled under, she had to hold her breath there, she was brought up with the shark, and we did it dozens and dozens of times. And it required the actors gaining some confidence in the shark. At first, they go, I'm not getting in that thing.
Want to go again quickly?
It's another very memorable moment that, again, without this computer-controlled shark and all those things, you just wouldn't achieve. You would never get the timing just right in that performance. So there's a lot of times when the actors aren't acting, they're just reacting.
In the water, speed is a problem. And controlling these sharks that are big and heavy is a problem. We realized that we also have to do some of the work digitally. So we knew that there is now the computer technology to create these beasts.
Wouldn't get that close if I were you. Just a suggestion.
Water's murky. Might make it.
We're not scheduled to kill Sam Jackson's character in that particular scene, but once again, it turned out that the shark, being as big and powerful as it is, and the state of that particular set, which was built cantilevered over a 40-foot deep tank, made it sort of very, very dangerous for the shark to actually jump out of the water and bite Sam. So we opted for safety again, which, you know, sometimes a bummer. Sam would have done it. He's a trooper.
I enjoy working with Rennie. He always taxes us in very physical ways. You know, I tended to forget that. I mean, all of a sudden, when they said, okay, you're shooting in Mexico, I went, hey, cool. Mexico, hot, it's gonna be all right. Weather's gonna be nice, probably a nice golf course around. And the uncomfortability of the shoot never occurred to me. It's like when I read it, it didn't read as wet as I'd been. It read a lot drier. And now it's like, okay, you're also soaking wet running down a hallway. You're also getting, you know, bombarded by tons of water. It's like, wait a minute. I never saw all this when I was reading it. It's just kind of, something's changed in the translation of being here, you know, of going from the page to getting here.
You've seen how bad things can get and how quick they can get that way. And they can get a whole lot worse.
We're going to have another CG shark leap up out of the pool in mid-sentence, grab Sam basically by the head and shoulders and yank him underwater.
First, we're going to seal off this pool.
It's very much the same technology they used in movies like Jurassic Park, where they actually create a 3D, completely living, breathing, moving shark in the computer. I challenge anybody to tell me what is real, what is not, how different things were done, because obviously now that I'm telling you that this one is here to CG, you'll know that, but we'll know one shot, but anything else, take a guess.